Welcome to the Startup Grind.
We're going to do a quick mic check. Is this a great audience?
Yes, it's wonderful. Got to talk to so many of you, and it's always fun to talk to people that are have something that they want to accomplish and move forward on. Especially, I enjoy talking to the little kids too.
that's right where we like to start.
That's right. Yeah.
When you were little, did you have things you wanted to accomplish?
Probably. Give you just a little background. I grew up out in the country outside of Ann Arbor. I went to a one-room country school. There was never more than 50 kids there, kindergarten through eighth grade, one teacher. And in my class, there was never another girl. There was only boys in my class. So we always played baseball together and did everything together, skated.
How did that impact you?
I've just always felt I could do anything. I never felt like I couldn't do something. And my mother was a big influence, and she always used to say the word American ends in I can. Means you, I can do anything. So I always remembered that, and I like to pass that on to people. That, you know, we can do anything if we want to and we're willing to put forth the effort and the time it takes to accomplish something.
That's a very cool message. You got that from your mother?
My mother.
Mm-hmm. What was she like?
She was a really interesting person. she grew up in Petoskey, Michigan. And her grandmother, whose name was Lois Davis, she was married to her husband was called Frank Davis. And this would have been back in the 1800s, and they cut down wood, and they would float down river, and he was the one in charge of that, getting the logs to float down river, and he was actually killed in a logging accident while he was doing that. And my mother's grandmother then was a widow with a young girl, my mother's mother, and she started a hotel or a resort on Walloon Lake and built that back in the early 1900s. And so there was that person first, you know, set the example of you can have your own business, you can do your own thing. And she ran that. It was very successful. It did burn down. I read where it burnt down because they were cleaning up the yard and the leaves caught on fire and went the whole thing. But she had that Walloon, it was called Eagle Island, was the name. And so they had that for quite a long time. My mother, when she was a young woman, her dad insisted that she go to college. She went to Miami University, but she didn't like it. She wanted to study fashion design. So she went to Chicago, and eventually she had her own shop there, and so she had her own business at a young age too, and eventually she came back to Michigan during the Depression, when alcohol was illegal.
Prohibition.
Thank you. And kind of a funny story. She had a girlfriend, and they had to leave Chicago, I guess, quickly during they went to, I guess that was a girlfriend's boyfriend was the issue, so they ended up in Milwaukee and eventually in Ann Arbor. So
so you had a few entrepreneurial influences, it sounds like, when you were
probably didn't know as appreciate it as much then. I was aware of it, but you know.
When you had that American and you had the I can, what did you think you wanted to do when you were older?
Oh, well, see, like when I went to school, of course, I wanted to go to college. And I went to college right out of high school. Then I went for about a year and a half, and I had met a guy before then, and then we got married, and he was going to go to dental school. And so I quit to help pay for that and get him through dental school, which would have been to my advantage. And then eventually I moved to East Lansing in 73. And to go to school at LCC, I was interested in becoming a paralegal. And so I went there to study. I had two small children then. They were 5 and 6 and a half. And so they went to school. The school, fortunately, was like a half block from my house. So I never had issues of trying to get them back and forth. But I went to LCC. And while I was going there, I had to work, because I was a single mom then, and I was waiting for the, I always took the bus back and forth from where I lived in East Lansing near Grand River down to LCC, and one day I had to go get a job. I needed, you know, to money, and this person stopped and asked if I wanted to ride. It was one of my professors, my class, and he had his little boy in the car, and he was going to drop him off at nursery school, and he asked me, I told him why I was going down to look for a job, and he said, can you type? And I said, yes. And he said he had a part-time job, and he worked at the Michigan Supreme Court in the Department of Legal Services. I ended up being hired there and worked there 13 years. It was very good. I met a lot of really great people and still maintain a lot of those friendships, people I know. So I worked there 13 years until my kids were finally out of high school, and that's when I quit, sold my house, quit my job, and went back to school at Michigan State University to finish up my bachelor's degree, and lived on campus, not with the students, not in the dorms, but they have housing in there, and so that's my education. I got it in hospitality business, because I thought I wanted to own a restaurant, although I'd never worked in a restaurant. I don't know why I thought that was a good idea, but I always enjoyed food and cooking. I started cooking at a very young age. I enjoyed listening to Linda Hunt talk about her pie making. I did that too. I loved to cook and do that. So I was always kind of interested in that. But so
that was fortuitous.
It was, yeah. So I ended up having to get a job in the restaurant business to see, that's really, you have to have experience doing that when you're going to get a degree in hospitality, some form of hospitality. So I got a job at Flapjack Restaurant, and the owners were Bud and Eleanor Wasson, and another guy there, he was the night manager, and he also was in the same program I was at the hospitality business school. And he was getting the same degree, and we graduated at the same time, and his name is Bob Fish. And he was, I started Biggby with Bob Fish. But that's how I met him. We worked at the Frandor Flapjack for several years while we were finishing school. And then the owners wanted to build a second store on South Cedar, so we ran the Flap, the one at Frandor. And eventually, the owners wanted to come back to that store, and we went and operated the one on South Cedar. And also, the owners, Bud and Eleanor, gave us the opportunity of owning our own store. So then Bob and I and another partner built the one out on Waverly and ran that for about 3 years.
Wow, there's a lot there.
Yes.
Well, one thing I want to touch on before I forget is it sounds like they give you the opportunity to own your own store.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
How did that work? It was almost like a mini franchise, or?
Well, Flapjack was a franchise. It started in Traverse City, so from some family members of Bud and Eleanor, and so they enabled us to do it. You know, helped us get started, and Bob worked out all the financial things about that. So we own that, like I said, about 3 years, and then we wanted to do something else. So we sold that store to our business partner, and he owned that and ran it for quite a while. And then we started investigating coffee shops. We're just starting to come in. There were a lot of them in the greater Lansing area. Actually, there were 23 of them, but they were all like mom and pop coffee shops. So we were sort of interested. Starbucks had just forayed out of Seattle. They just opened a couple stores in Chicago to test to see how they would get product back and forth and that sort of thing. So that was first place. And so we went and looked at those stores and several other ones. There were Seattle's Best and a couple like that. Went to Chicago and looked at those. We ended up going also right to Seattle itself to see what the coffee industry was like out there. There were a lot of roasting facilities there, a lot of known coffee shops that were Café de Arte, which was known for their art on their coffee, and various places like that. So we visited. It's quite different than Michigan because there were a lot of like outdoor, small little buildings that you drive up to. The weather, they don't get snow. So you could just drive up and order your coffee and they'd bring it out to your car. And they'd be shaped like coffee pots and kind of funny.
I'm wondering how much of this was planned, because it seems like looking back, you could say when you're at the Supreme Court, you were maybe dreaming of having your own business in the food service industry and that you went to school for that.
No, when I was at the Supreme Court, I actually thought about going to law school. Toyed that for a while. And then decided, I don't think I can sit in a room and read and write briefs. I love the law, but that's not my personality. I like people, I like to be out, I like to talk to people. So I realized that that probably was not going to be a good fit for me, and I liked the whole idea of, you know, working with the public and having my own business.
So at some point when you're at the Supreme Court, you decided you wanted to have your own restaurant, and that's what you went to school for?
Well, I actually what I thought was not the restaurant part. I actually thought, wouldn't it be fun to have run a hotel like in Chicago, and you live in the hotel and you could just, you know, go out on the streets. Wouldn't that be fun? So that's what I was thinking. And then probably not realistic, but then after I worked in the restaurant, I love the energy. I love talking to people. I like training. I like, you know, having working with the staff and all, and figuring things out. You know, new menu items or how things would work better. I like that aspect of it. So it was a good fit for me.
For people out in the audience, how do you think they should be thinking about starting a business? You know, they have a job right now, and how should they think about that?
Well, I think you have to, if you don't have an idea exactly what you want to do, but you always want to have your own business, you know, try to narrow it down. And don't be afraid. You know, you might try something, it doesn't work. That's okay. You might try something and it might not work, so you try it a little differently. And the thing is, you know, you want to recognize opportunity and try things, but I always tell people, something's not working, cut your losses and move on. You know, don't keep trying to make something work that possibly cannot, or the way you see it. So don't be afraid to try something new also to get to your goal.
Yeah. How do you know when it's time to cut, like you said, versus, you know, just push through?
Well,
because everything's hard, right?
Yeah. If it comes too easy, then is it worth having? I don't know. You have to work. I'll give you an example, when you know. When we first started, we had one store. And then everybody wanted, we'd have customers come in and various people, and how can we have a store? How can we have a store? And we always thought we wanted multiple stores, but the big decision is, do you want corporate or do you want franchise or do you want both? So we had our second store that we owned, and by then we started selling franchises. So our third, fourth, and fifth store, were franchises. But then we thought, should we try the corporate idea of having corporate stores? And so we bought out in Toledo, Ohio. There, a mother and two daughters owned five coffee shops there, and they wanted to get out of the business. So we bought them, and we're going to run them as corporate stores. And I was the one that had to go down there and convert all these stores to Big Beaners back then. But it was a lot of hard work going in and to that building, because you didn't have a blank space. You're trying to convert an existing shop to be your shop, not look like their shop. And it was a lot of work to do that. And we ran those five stores for a while and quickly decided that we don't want to do corporate stores, because you have two different systems. You know, when you're franchising, you're supporting the franchise people in helping them do their run their stores a particular way. But when you have corporate stores too, you got to keep a staff always in line. You're running that store, you're operating it. It's a different thing, and it was a distraction to us, and we decided no, we don't want to do corporate stores.
So you tried it out, and then it didn't feel right, and you're having success just, elsewhere?
Right. We just decided to go a franchising route. And there's something nice about franchising, too. You're giving people an opportunity to own their own business. The first franchisee we had, she was a school teacher. The second one we had was a former employee wanted to have a store. And the fifth one, store that we had was a woman that ran a daycare center. And so, and then now we have people that own, you know, some of them have Wendy's. There's all different backgrounds of people, and you're giving them an opportunity to own their own business. You're guiding them through. They don't have to figure out all those things, the systems and all the things that you had to figure out. You're giving them a workable system that if they follow, they will be successful.
I think there's a lot of people who are thinking about starting a business and they haven't taken that plunge and they have a dream.
Yep.
Do you think a franchise is a good idea for people in the audience who are thinking of owning their own business?
It's a good way to learn. You're learning. There's a steep learning curve when you own your own business. You're going to try some things and they don't work, and then you have to try some other things. And it's a lot of hard work. You're there long hours and all of that. If you go into a proven concept, you know, a franchise, somebody else has already figured all that out. And you go in and you follow the system and you will be successful. Now, also in a franchise, you have to hear feedback from the franchisees too, because they are learning out there and they can help you, you know, the company grow also. They give feedback. So and we listen to our franchisees. They have groups that they form in their area. So like Grand Rapids has a group where the franchisees all get together and they talk about, you know, ways that this could be approved. And then as a cohesive idea, they bring that to our office rather than everybody jumping in and, you know. So, and that and they refine the idea more because they're getting more voices there and if it's workable. Because a lot of people have ideas that are just not going to work. And so that group, that meeting together as groups helps, you know, get rid of those ideas that aren't going to work. But they bring good ideas to us that help us be better.
When you were talking about your educational journey, the other thing I was thinking about was, sounds like you're maybe set, you know, at the Supreme Court, sounds like you got your kids off to college and
yeah,
seemed like things were going pretty well, and you made what seems like it might be a risky decision to quit work.
Nothing ventured, nothing gained.
And go to school.
Nothing ventured, nothing gained.
how were you feeling when you made that? Was it an easy choice or were you nervous?
No, I guess, you know, I've always been a person that is willing to try things. I'm not a person who's afraid, or I figure things out. I figure out how I'm going to do it, and then I do it. Yeah, pretty much like that. But I enjoyed it while I was there, but I thought that I could do more and that I had fulfilled my responsibility as a parent, raised my children, got them in college. My son graduated the year after I did. So, I did that part, and I figured I could take some rest. And I could always get another job if it didn't work out, right?
For people out in the audience who want to quit but haven't taken that plunge yet, how should they think about when it's the right time to do that or if it's the right decision?
Well, I suppose I was by myself, so I figured the only person this was going to affect was me. So, but if you have a family and children, but if you have somebody that can help you and you're a teammate or somebody, I think that really helps. And I mean, you have to look at everything. You can't be afraid to try something, but you have to know whether it's a foolish risk or whether it has potential. Have you really thought it through? And I think, if I had small children and I was their sole provider, and maybe, I would play it safer than when they, got their education, they could take care of themselves, one hopes. And then you could risk, because I thought, what's the worst thing that could happen? I could just go get a job,
Yeah. And so then, moving on, you started at MSU, and then it sounds like you're working at a restaurant, and then you and Bob opened up another restaurant, right. And you were also classmates together?
Yes.
When did you think that there might be a partnership there, and how did that evolve? Yeah,
we were always sort of on the same wavelength. We always worked well together. Like in the restaurants, I would do one shift and he'd do another one. And we did that too when we opened our first store. But it was just good. He knew the back of the house and that part, and I learned all about the front of the house, and I loved training people. I don't know if people have been in Flapjacks, but it's a very friendly place. It was hugely busy, really busy. There could be 40 people waiting in line, and you learn how to really get people taken care of and that sort of thing. So we worked well together. So we complemented one another. And even, when we started our coffee shop, he was really good in marketing and that sort of thing. And I loved to figure out systems and training, and I loved designing the stores, the flow of the work, and that sort of thing. And he did, and I'll tell you this story. When in our first store, been open a few months, and this young guy walked in and was looking for a job in the summer. He had just graduated from Kalamazoo College. He'd studied economics, and he was wanted to go on and get his master's degree. And he was working there as a barista, and I would talk to him and, chat about what he was doing, what he wanted to do, and that sort of thing. I gave him a lot of grief, too. He was easy. And I finally talked to Bob. I said, you really should talk to him. I think he'd be a good addition, because he was like the financial person. So it turns out he did talk to him. He did come on. He became a partner. And today's the president of our company. Bob's the CEO, and Mike McFall, that's the gentleman, is the president of the company. And I was vice president. So that all worked out. We were very complementary. You had each of us had a different talent, and so it worked out really well. Because a lot of times, if you're going to have partners, you each have a particular area that you're good in, and you let that person, move ahead with that. I knew nothing about marketing. That was Bob, Biggby Bob. He does all that. So that worked out really well.
How do you think people in the audience should think about whether to go it alone or to have a partnership?
I guess it would depend on the type of business you have. I think partnership, you know, we're not talented in everything. You know, everybody is good in some area. You have your strong suits, and we all have weaknesses. And so if you can find somebody who complements you, you can grow together, you know, this company or this idea or business. If you're both the same, then it's harder, I think. But we need that complement to help, because we're not good at everything. None of us are.
And how do you know when to partner with somebody versus hire them or have them hire you?
Well, I guess it would depend on the kind of person you are. If you are really good at inspiring people and getting them to be on board with you and telling them exactly what you need from them, then maybe you hire them, somebody to do that. But then you got to let them do their job, tell them what you want, what you expect, and let them do their job. If you need a partner, maybe you have certain things you can't do and you want to share and you want the help and somebody in it for you. Maybe you do it for financial reasons or so I think we all know what kind of person we are, whether we work well with other people or just are, you know, an individual that you don't want anybody around you. Which I'm not like that.
And so if somebody in the audience decides to have a partnership, how should they decide who gets what percentage of the company?
It's always tricky. If you're both in it together and you started it together and you put in the same amount of money, why wouldn't you be equal? If you put in a bigger amount, maybe they have a lesser percentage then of, but we were always equal, you know, just we were in it together. We were always equal. But we all had our area of responsibility and expertise and that sort of thing. And we might talk about, you know, in a meeting, there was another person we added later who had a lesser amount in the company, but he was a real estate person. But we'd meet and talk about how we wanted to grow and what we wanted to do and how we should change. And because when we started, it was just Mike, Bob, and myself, and we had two people who had worked for us at the first store. But when we had a separate office and we're no longer working in the store, we were starting a franchise, we ran the company. But as you grow, if you're going to grow, you've got to have other people. You're not good at everything. So now we have people that, you know, might design our marketing pieces or our advertising or that sort of thing. And then we have people that train the franchisees or open stores. So everybody has it's a different person for each one of those jobs.
And speaking of growth, how did you, you quit your job at the court mm-hmm. to have your own business, which you then succeeded in having your own business when you opened your own Flapjacks
right.
restaurant.
Mm-hmm.
Why didn't you just stop there?
Well, the owner of the franchise company, Bud and Eleanor, brought the restaurants down here. Bob and I had started having a little different vision. We knew coffee was starting, and we sort of wanted to add, that coffee idea to the restaurant. But this was not our concept. It was their concept. And so they weren't that interested, so we just decided we would go out on our own and develop this coffee concept that seemed to be really growing in communities. People were interested. And Bob had grown up in Germany, always loved coffee, so he was very into that. I have to be honest, I never really liked coffee until I was 40, but Because I grew up in, my parents had a percolator, bought, you know, Hills Brothers Coffee, and it was on the back of the stove all day, and it wasn't good after a while. So. But when I had really good coffee, it was good. I enjoyed it. It's like bad wine and good wine, you know, wine coolers versus Cabernet, you know, it's a big difference. So you develop a taste.
When you and Bob then were forming your partnership and maybe you were at the Flapjacks, were you out there seeking other ideas and looking for a coffee concept or smaller concepts, or did it?
No, I think we always thought we wanted to have our own. We were going to develop our own concept, and that's why we did a lot of studying. We went to Seattle, like I said, and looked at a lot of different ones. We had a roaster out there that we used in the beginning. They roasted to our specs. Their coffee was really good. But, you know, that was fine when you have one or two stores because they had to ship it to us. But when you start getting, you know, 30 stores, then that's not economically feasible. So at some point we had the idea and all of that. We had to find a local roaster, which one right here in town, been there a long time. And so Bob went and talked to them and got them to roast to our specs what we wanted. And he still works with them, their roaster there. And Bob's the palate for the company. He tastes all the coffee. And so when we had local company doing it for us, it was a lot easier. In the beginning, they delivered to our stores directly. But at some point, that wasn't possible because we started going, we're in Wisconsin and Chicago and Indiana, or Illinois and Indiana, and then Florida and Texas. And at some point, they can't deliver it. So eventually, Bob made arrangements with Cisco Food Service, which is all over the U.S., to deliver the coffee. So the franchisee could call up and order the coffee from Paramount Coffee, and then that would be, Cisco would pick it up and deliver it to the different stores throughout our whole area.
So it sounds like from the beginning you knew you wanted to build something that was bigger than,
yes,
than one restaurant. How big did you want to build something? Did you want to conquer the world, or?
Sure, why not? No, I don't think you can't get overwhelmed. So you start out small, like our first stores out of the Lansing area. Well, remember Toledo? We went down there and worked there. And when we were in Toledo too, we met Barry Greenblatt, who owns Barry Bagels, and we formed a relationship with him. All our bagels today come from Barry Bagels, and they also get sent to Cisco and delivered that way. But, you know, when we started getting in Wisconsin and or Florida and Texas, then things have to change. You can't.
So you knew you wanted to get big, but you didn't really have an idea of how big you wanted to get your...
No, you don't want to put limits on yourself. People kept just asking. When we first started to grow our business, you know, we had Grand Rapids, and there's a lot of franchises in Grand Rapids. You know, Kalamazoo was another one that really grew. Now we're working on the whole Detroit area, and Flint and Saginaw, and so a lot of those places in Michigan, because you want to own the state. You want that to be, you know, this is our home state, and we want to be everywhere in it. And so, but gradually you start growing out, but we've tried to control that too. People have been interested, so we've sort of stayed in the Midwest, and we have a few, we had people that were interested in Florida and Georgia and South Carolina and some other states, but you know, we tried that because you develop your systems and see how that's going to work and that sort of thing. So, but mostly we concentrate in the Midwest. You don't want one store in each state. That doesn't make sense. There's no synergy there. Nobody knows you. You're just, you know, a single store. So you want to grow a whole area.
As you were building out Biggby, how did you think about setting growth targets?
That would be a Bob Fish question.
Because you're on the system side.
Yeah.
He would set the targets and you would have
Yeah, he would do that. And I would go, I would train. I'd go and take care of the build outs of the stores. I was there, you know, supervising it, following up, making sure it was built out correctly, working with the contractors. And then I would train. I also did training the first employees for the store. You'd go down there and you'd train them the week before they open. You put them through this whole training procedure. And then you were there, and then I was there the week of opening. So that's a lot of what I did. So I got to go a lot of different places, Texas, and South Carolina, and Georgia, and, you know, Ohio, of course, and Wisconsin, because those were all the stores that I was involved in. Yeah.
When you look back at growing this massive business, were there any pivotal points where something happened that changed the course of the company?
Are we getting around to the name change? Is that what you No. No,
just things that maybe made your sales go like this? Oh,
yeah.
Or...
Well, I think people really liked us. Customers are funny. Sometimes they're for the underdog. And, you know, you'll have a real big company will come in, but they want to support local. And we always were like the local people. We always encouraged our franchisees to be very involved in the community they were in. And many of them were, because they were from that community and they were involved. And that was really important. Where if you get an outsider to come, you know, corporate store of some sort come in, maybe they're not as involved because they've sent their people there. Their owners, they're not the owners that live in that community, possibly. So that was always important to us, that our franchisees were really involved in the community and did things for the community, too.
And you feel like figuring that out moved the needle substantially?
What?
Do you feel like figuring that out, having the franchisees involved in the community, that really had an impact on,
oh, yeah,
on growth?
Yes. Yes, for sure. And because people come up to me all the time. They tell me the store they go to. They know the owners. They know the owners. They know what drink they like. Yeah, so I get that all the time. So the funniest instance I had, I was one time flying to Colorado. I have family that live there. And I got off the plane and I was walking down inside the airport. And there was somebody standing at the bottom with a Biggby cup. Because we don't have stores in Colorado. But somebody, that was really odd to see that. So, yeah.
And think about how Biggby grew from, you know, one location to over a couple hundred now or something.
Yeah.
How did you grow with the company? How did you keep up with all the changes of the demands on you?
Well, you can't do everything yourself. You have to have a staff. And so you hire people. And I always tell people this. You hire people that can do the job better than you can. So when in the beginning of any business, you're doing everything. I'm doing the bookkeeping. I'm doing the training. I'm doing the food ordering. I'm out there working. But you're doing the advertising. But when you get so big, you can't do that anymore. And you're not doing it well. You have to figure out what your strong suits are and hire people to do the things that they could do better than you. And because some people are always afraid to let go of control and that, but you can't grow if you won't let yourself, you know, you hold the reins too tight. You have to trust other people. You guide them, you show them how to do the job, and then you let them do it. So we like to do that in our company.
What's the most stressful experience you've had at Biggby?
Stressful. Well, when I went down to open those stores in Ohio, I was there by myself trying to do that, and they had been occupied by another coffee shop, so there was a lot of equipment there. There needed to be a lot of changes, and I was doing physical labor moving out various things. And that was hard, really hard. And But we didn't have like a big staff or anything, so it was me. And so that was the most stressful. Although I don't get too stressed out, so, but that was hard, really hard work.
How did you deal with that stress? You're down there all by yourself, and it sounds like you didn't like the work, but it had to get done.
No, I don't mind the work, but it had to get done. But it was physically hard and challenging, and trying to get those five stores all converted, change the interior the way it was laid out, hire all the staff, get them trained, and overseeing the opening of the store and making sure it was going to run. So it was a lot of work because you're doing five at once. And they also had two small areas in two of the hospitals down there, too, that we had to convert. One we decided not to. It wasn't worth it.
Do you have any tips for entrepreneurs when they feel overwhelmed by stress? How to get through that?
Well, I never let... I'm not really bothered by stress so much. I let things go. You got to stay active and take care of yourself and be able to step away for a little bit, you know. Some physical activity helps get rid of stress, I think. And, you know, you can't cut yourself off from life because you're so intent on this thing that you're working on. So you do have to get away from it, and I think that helps with alleviate stress.
Yep. Switching gears completely.
Okay.
How do you think entrepreneurs should think about how to differentiate from their competition?
You always want to be different and better. So when we first started, we went around and visited other coffee shops, not only here in town, but remember I told you in Seattle and that? We went and watched how they were doing it. And you can learn a lot, not only from people doing it right, you actually learn more by watching people who are not doing it right. Because you can see, you know, wow, that might have been better if they did it this way. And you can learn from that. So that was helpful to go around and watch and see how other people were doing it and learning from it. It's just like any learning situation. You learn from others.
Do you think it's smart to research the competition and
yes,
see what they're doing well and what's not working?
Yes, for sure. For sure. And we learned a lot from that, and like I said, you could learn more from people that maybe weren't doing it exactly right. But because of our restaurant background, we had certain things to our advantage that maybe others didn't if they were just starting a coffee shop. Because in a restaurant, you have multiple staff and they each have their own job. But when a person takes an order, then they go hang it, you know, it gets sent on a computer to the kitchen, and also hang a slip so that the cook can make sure it's coming up right. So there was a system there. And we'd go watch some coffee shops, there was no system. Somebody would take the order, and then they would go get the coffee or go make the drink. And the next person came up to order, and another person came in and took that order. So there was no system, and we said, wouldn't it be much easier to have a production line? You have the cashier that's taking the order, and it gets printed and sent to the next person, which we called the shot puller, and that was the person that set up the drink, put the flavor, pulled the espresso shot, and did that. And then it went to the next person, who we called the milk steamer, and that was the person that steamed the milk or finished the drink off, the whipped cream, and that sort of thing. So you had a little production line. And we used to call out the drinks, but that was just for atmosphere. We wouldn't depend on... I remember going to this one store in Chicago, and they were calling out every drink. The milk steamer can't remember all that. They had a line of people. They're calling out drinks for what reasons? You know, they didn't have slip printers that get sent to the milk steamer, so the people operating the espresso machine, so they could make sure the drink was made correctly. So if you got a line of people, you can't remember all that stuff. So we set those systems in place, and that really made us efficient. Everybody knew what they were supposed to be doing, And the other thing, if you go into our stores, who talks to you? The cashier will take your order and call it out, which is just for atmosphere, because remember, we got that slip printer. But the person that talks to you is the milk steamer, the one just standing there. We don't want anybody else to talk to you. They're supposed to be concentrating. But that person, we want them to engage with you. And people really notice that we were friendly. And one of our franchisees came up with the idea, let me backtrack. We hire a lot of young people that may not feel comfortable interacting yet. They don't have the right social skills. They haven't learned. Because talking with people, you have to learn how to do that. A lot of people are kind of shy. So they were supposed to interact with the customer. So one of our franchisees came up with the idea of having the blackboard that had the question of the day on it. And that was so that employee could say, oh, do you know the question of the day? And he would interact with the customer. That got him started, and then after a while, they just became comfortable saying, oh, how's your day? Where are you off to? How's your daughter? You know, all that sort of thing. But that helped them feel comfortable talking with the customer.
That's very cool.
Yeah.
We're going to take your audience questions now. If you guys want to line up over there. Stephanie doesn't know it yet, but I think she's going to handle the mic. Or Josh is running out there to handle the mic. Or he's asking a question. I don't know what he's doing.
I'll do whatever you need to do.
Look at that.
So I guess I'll start off with a question, and then I'll handle the mic afterwards. How about that?
Perfect.
So, Mary, you were talking about, if both partners are contribute equally to the partnership, then mm-hmm. why not be 50-50? Did you and Bob ever, or if something like that would have come up where there was a disagreement about how to go forward, how would you break the tie, so to speak?
Well, we always talked. We had regular meetings where we'd talk about what we want to do, or how do we want to handle this, or how do we want to grow, or that sort of thing. But we also had each of our areas that we were responsible for. So, Bob was responsible for a certain area, and I didn't intrude on that. If he'd ask, once in a while, and he didn't intrude on mine, but once in a while he'd interject. But so I think it's having confidence that your partners are doing, what they're supposed to be doing. Yeah. But we did have meetings and talk about direction and that sort of thing.
Thank you.
Yep.
I want to know, from Beaners to Biggby, why the change?
Okay. Well, let me tell you how we came up with the name Beaners. It used to be Beaners Cappuccino, and then it was Beaners Gourmet Coffee, and then it was Beaners Coffee, and then it was Biggby. But when we started growing, we had somebody in Texas that was interested in a coffee shop. And they said, we really like your idea, but we can't use that name here. And we said, why not? We didn't know. And they told us. And so we just changed it. It cost a lot of money to change, but you have to pick your battles. We did not know it was, an offensive name. And so we just changed it. And how we came up with that, I actually came up with the name. And Bob and I were riding in the car, and we were trying to think of names for the company. And we saw this one cappuccino, and that was good. And then we were trying to think of something before. And it was actually somebody drove by in a BMW. And what do we call people who drive BMWs? Beamers, it's the people who like. So I thought, oh, coffee beans. Let's call them Beaners. I had no clue that it was. That's how it came up, and so it was really innocent. Some things you just cut your losses, you move on. You have to pick your battles, and that was not something. Yeah.
I have a question for you, Mary, with regard to being a woman as a co-founder of a service industry type organization. You mentioned that Bob was always the one behind the marketing and kind of more of the softer idea side of it, and you were the one with systems and infrastructure type things. Did you experience along the way, despite your mother instilling this I can attitude and never really gave a thought to gender lines, but did you encounter any opposition or conflict as a woman doing more of the hardline aspect of business development?
No. I really never did. I was always kind of a confident person, not overbearing, or I don't mean like that, but I think we respected each of our talents, the things that we were good at. You know, I didn't tell Bob how to do marketing and that because I'm clueless, but I never ran into that. Now, maybe it's the way I grew up you know, always felt about myself, so I've never run into that.
Hi, Mary, this is Shay.
Hey.
I have two questions. Sure. One, do you see Biggby going into malls, airports, hotels, to spur scalability? And the second question is, do you think Tim Hortons has a regional monopoly in the Midwest that you are trying to capture?
Okay, as far as airports, we are in airports. Lansing airports and one, huh?
You can fly now.
Yeah. And in the Toledo airport. We're not in Chicago, we're those, but we are in those airports. What was this, the third thing you said?
About Tim Hortons having a regional monopoly in the Midwest.
Yeah, you know, you can't fasten on stuff like that. So, I mean, we want a regional monopoly. We want to own Detroit. We want, you know, you want to be, I think it's, what did they say? It's better to be a big fish in small pond and spread yourself too thin and, you know. One fish in an ocean, who cares, you know. So we keep growing. Want to own Michigan, want to move out. Yeah.
Hi. My question is about the implementation of your system. So both initially and then ongoing. So you talk about some of these things that you do in your stores. Is it something where the new franchise owners, they go through like a university? Do you have a manual? Do you have all of the above? And then after they've been at it for 6 months or a year or 5 years, how is their ongoing education? How do you implement the system?
Okay. All the new franchisees go through a training in our home office. We have a store in our home office. It looks just like a store. And so they have to go through training, not only in making all the drinks, but all the other aspects of running a business. So they get trained to do it our way. That way everybody's uniform, everybody's doing it the same thing. And then we also train their first staff, the one that they're going to use for opening the stores. We train that and help them get their store open. At some point, the owner of the store is going to pick somebody who's going to be their trainer. We call that a percolator. And that person, clever, right? So that person has to go through special training in our home office on how to train the new hires and keep the current staff all on board. So that person comes and gets training in our home office with percolators from other stores. So, and they have ongoing training too. It's not just like a one-time thing. It's, they have refresher and they can come back for more and get more information about new things that are going on and gonna happen to the company. We also have visits to the store where we'll go in and watch and see how they're doing. You know, are they following the correct procedure? Are they greeting the customer within three steps of the door? Those things are all important. Are they dressed appropriately? You know, are they looking like what we want Biggby employees to look like as far as their dress? How long has it taken for the drink to get there? So we'll go in, and I did this for a while to new stores. They didn't know me after, you know, the first stores, I knew everybody. But after a while, as you grow, you have other people doing a lot of that. So I was able to go into some stores. They didn't know me. And I would go order a drink, and then I'd go sit out in the restaurant and watch how they were doing. Was the drink made right? Did they follow procedures? Are they greeting customers? Are, you know, they picking up the place? So that's a constant thing to help them do that. But training is ongoing. It's not just one and done. It's always there.
Yeah. Just a quick follow-up question on that. That first foray of the training where they come to your corporate store, the mock-up of the store, how long is that? Is that days or a week?
Well, there's different aspects of it. The part where they're just learning how to make all the drinks and take care of the store, that's a full week. But then there's follow-up on that. The initial training takes a week. But then they have to learn all the other things, too. Bookkeeping and taxes and all pay and, you know, all that fun stuff. Yeah.
Hi, I wanted to get a discussion started more around the idea, the notion of whether to do things inside, internally, or to outsource. And maybe you could frame the response more specifically to, so in generic in nature, and then specifically something core to your business, like roasting your own beans. I guess what considerations did you go through to outsource that rather than, you know, as you're growing so aggressively to do that internally?
Well, running a roasting company is a big task. And that would be a whole nother thing than what we wanted to do. So we chose to pick a roaster outside. They have the equipment. We didn't know that business. We would have to learn that, hire people. It was just a lot easier to find a company that had been in business for decades, was very successful, would work with you, and not doing it. It's like you have a corn on the cob in your restaurant, so you're going to grow your own corn? No. So you're not going to do that. What was the other part you
asked? Well, it was more so just in generic and in starting off, you know, you got to pick your battles, as you said.
Right.
At what point do you outsource versus doing it internal? You know, and yeah, I'll let you respond to that.
Outsource, like for marketing or something like that?
Sure.
Okay.
Staffing or whatever it may be.
Yeah, well, in the beginning, we did outsource that because we had a very small staff. I mean, it was like five of us. And so we hired local people that develop our marketing plan and design our art and our billboards and all that kind of stuff. But as you grow, you can bring some of that in-house and you hire people to do that task. So in the beginning, you do depend on outside sources to do that. But I would not want to, you know, we have bagels. I don't want to start baking bagels, you know, or I don't want to start growing coffee, you know. Those are not things you, that would be a complete distraction. It's a whole nother business.
So you must have decided at one point, we are interested in the distribution of coffee, not the production.
Right.
Not the growing, the agriculture side.
Right. No, we just want to make good drinks and...
And it's at like, any point would you reconsider that? Mostly on the roasting. I assume that you've grown way beyond the local producer here. And so at what point would you consider either doing an acquisition or doing something inside?
Well, Paramount is a big company. They make a lot of roast coffee for a lot of different companies. It's not just us. They were big enough so they could take on us and help us grow and had the systems in place to help us grow and to get our coffee where we needed to be. So that's why we picked them. It was a good fit. There was synergy. Yeah. Yep.
Last one.
Thank you for your speech, and please understand for my poor English.
Oh, no.
I know there are lots of competitors in coffee shop market, including Starbucks, McDonald's, Panera Bread, but I know biggest coffee is growing and bigger and bigger now. What is your strategy to survive in this kind of red ocean? Please.
Well, you know something, competition's good. It makes you stronger. The weak won't survive, but those who are strong and able to compete and are willing to work hard will survive. So it makes us stronger and better. If we were the only ones, you know, you get lackadaisy, you know, might not work as hard. But if somebody else is right there waiting to take your market, it makes you work harder and get better and more streamlined. Yeah, so competition is good. And we're different than, you know, some of these other companies. We've tried to make our drinks fun with the names and that sort of thing. We involve our customers. You know, from the very beginning, customers would suggest drink names, and we had contests where they would come up. Even the employees were encouraged to develop drinks, and then we'd, you know, look at them and make sure they were all in line with what we wanted to do. So competition is good, and so it's good to have, you know, Starbucks and Tim Hortons and Dunkin' Donuts. They all have interesting stories, by the way. I think a lot of those people that started out, like Dunkin' Donuts, that was a guy, he had a little food truck, and, you know, he'd go around to the factories and in Massachusetts, Quincy, Massachusetts, and he always had coffee, and he kept his equipment really clean, and people really liked his coffee, and eventually he involved in having donuts and coffee. But he started out small. All these people did. So Howard Schultz, did you know he went to school on a football scholarship to Northern Michigan? Yep. He grew up in a family, just, you know, didn't have a lot of money, and so he went to school there, and after he finished school, he was selling the company he was working for, coffee makers, and this company in Seattle seemed to be buying a lot of them, and he wondered why, and he went and checked it out, and they were roasters, and they, to their good customers, they'd give them a coffee maker when they bought a certain amount of coffee. And he went there and investigated that and thought, oh, did you ever think about opening up a coffee shop, roasting it and that, and so the rest is history. But so a lot of these people, Fred DeLuca, Subway, you know, his neighbor, his parents didn't have money, they were, you know, less than middle class, I guess. They were hardworking people. His neighbor gave him $1,000 to open up a little sandwich cart that he started out with, and eventually that evolved into Subway. So all these people, you know, started out small, worked hard, had an idea, and I think they're all pretty successful.
Thank you. Before we close it out, I want to ask you one more question. What do you want to be remembered for?
Say it again?
What do you want to be remembered for?
Oh. I guess my energy. I don't know. Encouraging others. Yeah. Yeah. I've always been really interested in education and history and art and, you know, all that sort of thing. So that's the other thing, you know, something. You have to make sure that you take care of yourself so you can do all these things. So, 'cause some days you might get a chance to retire, and you might get to travel. And when you go to Florence, Italy, you might want to look, oh, that's Leonardo da Vinci. I remember reading about that. So, yeah. So stay interested in many things.
Well, thank you for sharing your wisdom with us. I appreciate that.
Thank you. Thank you.